Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. How can we get the most out of our genetic potential? Breakthroughs in science, research, and epigenetics show us that we're not simply stuck with the genes we inherited from our parents. In fact, it's lifestyle factors like nutrition, movement, mindset, and our environment that truly control the way that our genes are expressed. These simple choices we make every day snowball to create vitality and longevity, or ill health and disease, depending on how you live your life. So if you're interested in finding and treating the underlying causes of ill health instead of just chasing symptoms, this is the show for you. I'm honored that joining me on the show today is Dr. Jeffrey Bland, a world-renowned nutrition medicine expert, clinical biochemist, and best-selling author, often called the father of functional medicine. I think you're going to enjoy this one. Before we get to the interview, here's a review that came in for the Fat Burning Man podcast on Apple iTunes. They say, amazing podcast, 5 out of 5 stars. This is legitimately my favorite health podcast. Abel is relatable and has very good guests on all the time. I'm of the paleo keto-ish mindset with nutrition. I feel like Abel is the most balanced though and doesn't get so fringe that you feel like you have to become a monk to be healthy. Thanks so much for leaving that quick review. It definitely makes me smile. We do like to dabble in the fringe from time to time, but hopefully it doesn't scare too many of you away. And you certainly don't need to live like a monk to be healthy. We all deserve a bit of fun here and there too. And so to all of you out there who are listening, if you want to keep this free show coming your way, there are a couple of quick things that you can do to help. Number one, just go and find this podcast wherever you listen to podcasts and make sure that you're subscribed. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, of course, Google, Spotify, YouTube, Android, Pandora, Vimeo, Stitcher, TuneIn, Amazon, and many more. So wherever you get your podcasts, make sure that you click subscribe. And even better, if you have a quick moment, please leave us a review. It really helps. And if you'd like to follow along and get all 500 plus episodes of this show and much, much more, please visit us over at fatburningman.com. That's where you can find all of the episodes. You can get free downloads for signing up for the newsletter with quick start guides, recipes, and much, much more to get you results as quickly as possible. So don't forget that you can always find us at fatburningman.com as well, and we look forward to seeing you there. All right, let's get to this episode with Dr. Jeffrey Bland. We're talking about how to get the most out of our genetic potential, ways to find and treat the root cause instead of just chasing symptoms, how to turn back the clock by rejuvenating your immune system, why the gut is considered the second brain, surprising ways that artificial ingredients affect us, why the future of personalized medicine is looking very bright, and much more. Let's go hang out with Dr. Bland. Welcome back, folks. Today, I'm honored to be here with Dr. Jeffrey Bland, an internationally recognized leader in nutritional medicine who co-founded the Institute for Functional Medicine in 1991 and is known to many as the father of functional medicine. With a career in health that spans more than 4 decades, Dr. Bland is also a clinical biochemist, best-selling author, and educator who has traveled to more than 50 countries teaching healthcare practitioners about functional medicine. Dr. Bland, it's truly an honor to be here with you today. Thanks so much for joining us.
Oh, it's my great privilege and honor. Thank you. I think what you're doing to broaden the reach of understanding how people can grab onto their health and really make their life what they're aspiring to be in terms of health outcomes, very important role, and you're doing a fantastic job. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for saying so. Well, let's kind of go down that road, because one of the main pieces of your message that I'd love to highlight today is you talk about how it's not quite as simple as many people make it out to be, where you get good genes or bad genes and it stops there, the genetic determinism. But how can we actually get the most out of our genetic potential? Framing it that way, I think, is so much more empowering. So maybe you can just riff on that a little bit.
You know, it's really, I think, extraordinary that you picked that theme up as maybe the start of our conversation, because I've been doing this for a number of years. I've been in this field for more than 40 years. And I have to say that when I first started talking about that, getting the most out of your genes, which was probably in the 1980s, it really kind of fell on deaf ears. People just didn't understand that, because the concept was your genes are your genes. You didn't fill out an application card. You just got the luck of the draw. You hoped you got a good mix of whatever your mother and biological father gave you. But if you didn't, then woe is you. You just have to live with it. And that was kind of the dominant theme. As you mentioned, that's kind of what's called Mendelian determinism. It's as if when the sperm met the egg, that was all that there was and can't do anything after. So when I started talking about, actually, our genes have to get expressed. They're sitting there silently in every cell of our body, and they need to get expressed in unique ways, because the genes that are being expressed in your liver better be different than the genes that are being expressed in your heart or in your kidney or in your eye, or would be a mess. So you have different messages that are being expressed in different parts of your genes, your genetic history at different times. I call this the book of life. Your book of life is encoded in 23 chapters. Those are your 23 pairs of chromosomes. And half of those messages in your book came from your biological mother and half came from your biological father. But like all books, you're not reading every story in the book simultaneously. You are reading sections of the book. And that's how genetics works in our body. It's the genes are expressed in different ways at different times based upon not only where they are in the cell that they reside, but also the environment that that cell is exposed to. So if the cell is exposed to stress, then the genes that are going to be expressed are going to be different than when you're not stressed. If you're eating a bad diet, the genes in that cell that will be expressed will be different than the genes in that cell if you're eating a good diet, if you're getting good sleep, so forth and so on. And so what we started to learn from this is that, yes, our genetics are the architecture that might be considered the hardware, but then how the genes are expressed is really determined by our software. And the software is what then reads our genes and determines how we look, act, and feel. Now, in medicine, that's called our phenotype, how we look, act, and feel. So people might say, oh, I'm so sorry that I got the genes for obesity because my parents were both overweight and I have it in my family. And so one asks then the questions, are there really specific genes that make you obese or make you thin? And the answer is no, they're probably not specific genes. There are specific genes that control your metabolism and that control and regulate how you process food and energy and your exercise and so forth that then translate into your body weight. But they're not obesity genes. They're genes that regulate your function. And those genes can be modified in how they express themselves based upon the information that we're providing them. The information is how we live, how we eat, how we move, how we think. Those then send messages to the genes in those cells to say, hey, everything is cool here. Life is wonderful. We're in a bliss state. Just express the fact that we're really having a great day. Or the genes can be told a message, oh, geez, we're under alarm. We got a lot of bad stuff coming in. We got bad food. We got chemicals. We got stress. Oh, my word, this is danger. You better get prepared to fight a battle. Then the genes turn into vigilant warriors, and they produce things like inflammation. So it really is not the genes in and of themselves. It's the personality of how they're expressed that becomes important. And the most important takeaway from this whole story is that we control about 70% of how those genes are going to participate by the decisions that we make or the experiences that we have or the exposures that we encounter. That is 70% of the determination of our health, is through those processes of how they modulate gene expression.
And it cascades, right? It's not just you're strategically necessarily going after one gene, like you say, and that has one direct result. It's more just like, well, if you're not getting good sleep, you're more likely to eat worse in a lot of cases, right? You don't have the willpower that you probably should. You might not be as likely to exercise. And so these bad, this bad information for your genes and epigenetics can cascade and kind of snowball into ill health and disease down the road over time. Or if you're feeding your genes the right information through how you're moving, eating real foods as opposed to ultra processed foods and getting good sleep and all the rest of that, that can cascade. And you wake up in the morning and all of a sudden you feel like you want to go for a walk, or you feel like you want to do the good thing for your body or have a nice breakfast of real food as opposed to something terrible from a fast food establishment. So maybe you could talk to the cascading factors that do take time, right? It's not like you can make this change overnight and all of a sudden you have the best results possible right away. This is something that does take a bit of work and time to put into action.
Yeah, I think you said that beautifully. If you think of the body and its interaction with the outside world, that relationship that we share with the outside world is a system. It's really a system that is unique to us because we have our own unique genes. We have our own unique lifestyles. We have our own unique behavior patterns. We have our own unique likes and dislikes. So we create our own story. And our story is this network that you're describing of how all these things interconnect together because they're all sending signals to our genes. Now, I don't think most people ever think about that. What do you mean, Jeff, by signals? What I mean is that right now my voice is moving air, which is then communicating with people through the air that moves through their ear, their inner ear, and it moves something in their inner ear that creates a nervous system change that then they hear sound. And they translate that into a feeling. And the feeling could be, oh, I really like what he's saying, or oh, this is horrible, and that will change our emotions. And our emotions then will travel through our whole body. It could be a stressful response, it could be an unpleasant response, it could be a painful response, or it could be a joyous response. All of that relates to the signal called moving air that is translated through our ear into our nervous system and ultimately into our whole body. Well, it's not just sound, it's touch, it's light, it's mechanical stimulation, and it may even be thoughts and belief systems that are not so materialistic that we can measure them easily, but we know they're there because when we're with good people, we feel good. And it's hard to understand exactly how that occurred. But these messages that we're picking up in our body, and if you think about it at the cellular level, on the surface of every cell of the body are all these different, I'll call them antennae. They're called receptors. And those antennae are specifically there to pick up signals. And those signals could be light signals, they could be sound signals, they could be chemical signals, they could be signals related to mechanical pressure. Those signals then create the architecture that ultimately will define how we look, act, and feel. And over time, if we're shaped by signals that are causing our body to be alarmed, feeling that it's under siege or it's under stress or it's under threat, then it will shape our body. Not only shape it physically, but it'll shape it metabolically. And it's interesting to note that there are a number of research studies that have been done looking at the actual physical architecture by taking photographs of people over time when they're under high stress or when they're eating bad diets or when they're taking recreational drugs. And what you find is those people that have an environment that are sending signals to their body that are creating alarm, that they age much, much rapidly, more rapidly. You can see it visually. And then you say, well, hold it. If they're doing that outside, what's happening inside? Inside, they're going through the same process. Their biological aging is increasing. The age of their organs, the age of their immune system, and we call that immunosenescence. And, you know, as we look at what happened with SARS-CoV-2 infection, we saw some people, when exposed to the virus, had virtually no symptoms or problem at all, that they maybe not even got infected. Whereas other people, it was a life-threatening, maybe even a terminal end-of-life experience. What was the difference? Well, it turns out the difference appears to be related to how much resilience a person's immune systems had. And the resilience was dependent upon the years before what they were exposed to that were either putting things into the bank account for immune function or taking out of the bank account. So they might have had diabetes, or they might have had high blood pressure, or they might have had insulin resistance, or they might have had autoimmune diseases. Those conditions then alter the reserve of the immune system. It's the same genes in those immune cells. They're just now expressing alarm, which then lowers your body's resilience to something else like the SARS-CoV-2. So if we were to say, does this sound then like we had a pandemic within a pandemic? We already had a pandemic of people with immune dysfunction because their genes or their immune systems were under alarm before they were exposed to SARS-CoV-2. Now we lay on top the virus as the second factor, the triggering factor, and lo and behold, now we have a global pandemic that's most affecting those individuals with the most compromised immune systems. So this concept is not just abstract theoretical talk. This translates into real outcomes as it relates to how people look, act, and feel, and how they age, their biological agings, what things they're having to fight. Are they always fighting their weight? Is that become something that they just can't seem to get on top of? Because weight, excess body fat, particularly visceral body fat, is basically a manifestation. It comes as a result of genes in our body expressing alarm. And when they express alarm, they store calories of food for a rainy day that never comes. And we become increased body weight, not because necessarily we ate too many calories, but because the calories weren't processed correctly. They got stored rather than used.
And we so often, especially in the Western world, talk about strengthening and bolstering and boosting the immune system and adding more and more and more and pushing and that sort of thing. Where I've heard you talk about, I think it was with a friend of the show, Jim Quick, on his podcast show, and Jim is great. You talk about the difference between balancing versus boosting or strengthening. And when we're talking about the immune system, it's not necessarily about adding more. It's about getting everything into that balance that you've talked about.
Oh, I think, again, Abel, that's right on spot. Because, you know, one of the major problems we're having right now is increasing numbers of autoimmune diseases. There's 8 different types of autoimmune diseases: multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus. The thyroiditis. The list goes on. And that's where it sounds like autoimmune, like the body's attacking itself. And so it's like we became allergic to ourselves. Why would we suddenly, one day, wake up and say, "Oh, I don't like myself anymore. I'm going to have my immune system attack me." Attack my thyroid gland, or attack my adrenal glands, or attack whatever the organ is. And the answer to that question is no, it's actually not becoming allergic to ourselves. It's because our body's immune system sees that there's something going on that it perceives as a foreigner, as a threat. And so it tries to reach out to get rid of that threat. It's doing what it's supposed to do, actually, which is to try to do battle. So let's say that you're in that state, that you're in a state of either pre-autoimmune disease or autoimmune disease. You've got a highly activated immune system that's already sending out a lot of messages to do battle. And now you say, "Oh, I want to boost my immune system to have it work better." Well, if you're boosting something that's already aggravated, what does that do? That boosts aggravation. And in terms of COVID-19, that's probably the extreme example, but we had these people that actually had their serious illness ultimately leading to death as a consequence of their immune systems running wild. It was overactive. So if you gave them an immune booster, that would be actually contributing to the problem, not reducing the problem. So that was called cytokine storm. That was the name that was applied to that condition. Cytokines are things that our body produces that are reactive substances in the face of danger. So it produces these anti-danger molecules that are inflammatory molecules. They increase inflammation. So I think that what we're really saying is balanced is the watchword for good health. We want to form the resting point where the body knows how to respond. It has a native intelligence. If we give it the right tools, it knows like, "Oh, I need to turn it on," or "No, I need to turn it off. I need to find the right balance." Because when we find that balance point, that equilibrium point, the body is in a state of optimal health. So our whole approach recently has been to find how we rejuvenate the immune system to find its balance, not just activate an already damaged immune system. That doesn't appear very intelligent.
Yeah, and balance is not the word that most people are after when they come in to health and try to improve something rapidly or quickly. Oftentimes, it takes some sort of major disturbance or illness or disease popping up in someone's life for them to take control of their health again. But often, to continue on that point, it's not about adding more and more and more. It is about that balance. So what are some of the things that people might consider subtracting from their lifestyle today? Because so much of our environment, our food, our the way that we live is a mismatch to the genetics that we come here with.
That's something we've been actively involved in researching with my research group. And, you know, we're one of many, many, many people that are engaged in this kind of research. But I think there are things that have come out of not just our work, but many others that look like common themes. So it's not like, oh, gee, you're speaking like no one else is speaking. So at the head of the list is relationships to insulin management. So when you have what's called dysinsulinism, or you've got insulin resistance, or you've got too much insulin in your body that's not working effectively in managing your blood sugar, that is a very significant contributor to problems of immune imbalance. And that's why people with diabetes had more problems with SARS-CoV-2 infection, because their immune system was suffering from an imbalance and a lack of proper ability to use the hormone insulin, which is a hormone that regulates our blood sugar level very effectively. It's not the only one, but it's a very central one. And so what is it that contributes to alteration in insulin, in insulin sensitivity? Well, not too many years ago, well, maybe it is for some people a lot of years ago. I have to put things in the relative of my life now, which is 77 years, so I have to recognize that's a lot of years. But a few decades ago, it was felt that the level of diabetes in our population was constant. It was about 2% of the population that had diabetes. And when I was in medical school back in the 60s, that was the general thing that we learned, that was just kind of with our population at that level. Today, 2023, in the United States, the prevalence of diabetes is approaching 10%, five times higher. That's a pandemic, by the way, or at least an epidemic. Yeah. And it then begs the question, did we suddenly start having different genes 20 years ago that were diabetic genes? Or did something else happen? Well, of course, you know what I'm going to say. We didn't just suddenly wake up with diabetic genes. That our genes actually have remained the same. What has changed is what we're feeding the genes and the information we're providing them. So that's the high refined carbohydrate diet, the high sugar diet, the high saturated fat diet, the underactivity, too much alcohol. All of those factors contribute then to insulin resistance. Now, when we look at this kind of from a question position, why did this suddenly happen? Why did we go from 2% to 10% of the population having diabetes? What was there an event that triggered this? I think this is somewhat controversial, but I believe there are more and more people that are coming to the recognition that it wasn't just coincidental that this condition started to become much more prevalent in our population when the dietary goals were published and they were translated by the food industry into a new class of convenience snack foods and processed foods. The dietary goals of the McGovern Committee that were published in the 1970s talked about reducing fat in the diet and staying away from too much cholesterol in the diet. So that it was a very fat-centric recommendation for the public. And then we saw a lot of food companies say, okay, good, so we're going to make all these cholesterol-free products. We're going to make fat-free products. Okay, when you take fat out of food, you still have to have 100% of the calories, so what are you going to replace it with if you're taking fat out? And what the food industry said is, well, let's put things in it that really people love to eat So they'll buy more of it. And by the way, it's really cheap, so we will make a lot more money. And that's sugar. And it was high fructose corn syrup sweetener. Now, before that, you would not find high fructose corn syrup sweetener or fructose in food products in any prevalence. The sugar that was in food at that point was, the smaller amount was in sucrose, cane sugar, basically, or beet sugar. But then suddenly we got into using corn from our mid-America to make sweetener. And it, this liquid sweetener could be put in everything. And it was very inexpensive, and people loved it. They liked sweet. And so what happened over those now from the 70s on with the introduction of those foods is that the food industry created an epidemic, the epidemic of insulin resistance. And it was aided in part by the translation of the dietary goals, unfortunately, that the government published in the 70s. Now we can say, well, hold up just a minute. Wasn't this like a nutrition experiment that was put on the whole of our population that didn't have a placebo control, that wasn't approved? We didn't sign up for this study. We just received it. And yes, we were uninformed participants in an uncontrolled population study to see what a high fructose corn syrup sweetener processed refined flour diet would do to the American public's health. And the results are in bad news. Obesity, diabetes, dementia, I could go down the list here, immune dysfunction, and increased risk to infection, including SARS-CoV-2. So this is not a good story. Fortunately, I think we have maybe quietly learned, when I say we, I'm talking about government, and maybe the food industry is becoming more enlightened. I am happy to see the natural food industry took a position against this from the very beginning. I'm proud to consider myself part of that industry from my last 50 years involved, because I think they held the line saying, no, this is not a good idea. Don't start eating this way. Now we learn about the microbiome and what happens when you feed a bunch of sugar to the microbiome. It becomes unfriendly and it produces dysbiosis and that produces inflammation. So we learn more and more about what we did to ourselves. And now we can turn it around. That's the good news. It's not a one-way street. So the first thing for our immune rejuvenation, I've gone in probably a longer degree of length than you wanted, but it's we need to get back to eating closer to the land, eating unrefined complex carbohydrate and plant foods, staying away from refined carbohydrates to the extent possible, certainly giving up all the sugar, over 130 pounds a person per year on average. You know, that number is a little bit misleading because it's 130 pounds per person on average, but there is actually a tremendous standard deviation because there are a lot of people that don't consume much sugar, and then there are some people that are just sugarholics. They're consuming over 250 pounds a year. And I mean, I can tell you that for sure will produce obesity, diabetes, heart disease, dementia. Just go down the list of the chronic illnesses that we're experiencing. So that would be number one on my list. I can go on from there, but let me take a breath and let you have some time here.
Well, I'll just quickly comment that it has become more and more shocking as the years have ticked by for me. I've been doing this podcast for more than 10 years now, and coming up on just past 20 years since I graduated from high school. And so getting back in touch with some of the folks who are literally the same age as I am, but catching up with them for the first time in 5 or 10 years, I'm like, oh my gosh, I suddenly feel very middle-aged when I look at some of my peers. Because people are aging in rapidly different ways. And I have noticed that those, like I did cross-country running back in high school, and a lot of my friends who have continued to run or continued to be athletes as they approach middle age, it seems like they still look more like they're in their 30s, whereas the people who have been, working very, very hard, probably in front of a computer, not sleeping very much, drinking too much, and that sort of thing. It's like they look like they're in their 50s now. And I just wanted to add and empower people out there to the fact that we're not stuck in our bodies and stuck with these results necessarily. Even people who have had this sort of accelerated aging process continue over the years. That is somewhat reversible. But once again, it does take time. It takes effort. But our bodies are built to heal from all of these injurious foods and lifestyle activities that we've all participated in, knowingly or not.
That's exactly correct. This is the enlightened story. I call it the biology of hope. Because a lot of people today have been beaten down. They've been beaten down by all the problems of COVID as a pandemic. They've been beaten down by the economy whipsawing. They've been beaten down by climate problems, environmental problems, social problems. I mean, the list goes on. And there's a lot of depression. There's a lot of despair. There's a lot of fear that's floating around in our culture right now. So how do we reinstill hope? We do so by grabbing on to the wheel that drives our car, taking charge of ourselves as we can, and doing the one thing that we do have control over, which is us. There are many things that we don't have control over, but we can control us. And this is one of the really important lessons, I think, because when you do that, when you reinstill this biology of hope that we can be in control of ourselves, we can eat the right things, we can exercise, we can think the right thoughts, we can hang out with the right people, we can stay away from toxins, we can celebrate life, we can have a spiritual belief system that renews us, all those things, it can turn around so many of the feelings of despair, of anger, frustration, negative thoughts, depression. And I'm just always concerned when I look and I see the number of suicide deaths, or I see the number of deaths to drug overdose. And I ask the question, how do those people get to that point in their lives in which the value of their life was so compromised that the solution was either exiting life or taking a dangerous chemical that's jeopardized their life? When actually by taking charge of their life, they can have a natural high. They can experience the bliss that's native in the goodness of our heart if we can fully express that white light. And you know, that's why we have focused a lot of our attention over the last few years on what I call immunorejuvenation. Because we think if we can rejuvenate the immune system, which is very possible by eating and living and doing the right things, that will translate to improving health of every organ in our body. And that causes us then to have collateral positive effects on, we're going to eat foods that are going to have a better effect on our blood sugar and our insulin levels. It's going to be less inflammation. We're going to have better brain function. We're going to sleep better. We're going to have more energy. We're going to be more alert. We're going to enjoy life more. Gee whiz, these sound like pretty positive feedback. I always think of the term life insurance. You know, when we buy life insurance, what is it really? It's death insurance.
Right.
It pays beneficiaries for our demise. Life insurance is doing something to live a better life. That's what we're doing. We're ensuring a good life by rejuvenating our immune system. And that's what led us into, you know, discovering various things that really have been helpful in our studies to show that people can rejuvenate their vitality, their resilience, and their immune function. We can turn back the aging clock. We can take an aged immune system and make it younger. These are real scientific validities that can be demonstrated by studies.
And thankfully, the microbiome, which you brought up before, is getting a lot more attention in recent years than maybe in the past. But still, I think a lot of people don't understand the deep connection between the gut and the brain, our mood. And you've even talked about how the health of our gut or the state of our gut can affect our dreams. So we don't necessarily know how deeply a lot of our organs, or especially the system, are affecting us for better or worse. So maybe you could talk about that for a little.
Yes, I think that's a really important topic. So as you mentioned in the introduction, I'm one of the founders of the Institute for Functional Medicine, and we've since 1991 been producing an annual international conference. One of those conferences in the 1990s, middle 1990s actually, was in Florida, and one of our keynote speakers was a gentleman by the name of Dr. Michael Gerson, G-R-S-H-O-N, He's a gastroenterological researcher and gastroenterologist by practice. And he had just authored a book at the time, which was becoming kind of a bestseller. It was called The Second Brain. And the second brain was the gut, because what he pointed out is that there are as many neurons in the gut, and that's nervous system connections, as there are in portions of the brain. So the gut is a brain connector to our central nervous system up above our neck. And they intimately talk together, both through nervous system direct function and through chemical messaging, like neurotransmitters, like things like oxytocin, vasopressin, cholecystokinin, serotonin. These are chemicals that the body produces at crosstalk between different organs, including the brain and the gut immune system. And so what he pointed out, this is back in the 90s, is that if you have a friendly gut, you can have a friendly brain. Or if you have an unfriendly brain, you can have an unfriendly gut. and he actually talked about conditions like chronic irritable bowel syndrome, which CIBS, which about a quarter of the population at any time in the United States has a form of CIBS. It could be the diarrhea form or the constipation form or the pain form, but they have some digestive problem that's called chronic irritable bowel syndrome. And it turns out that that condition is very closely related to our mood state. So chronic irritable bowel produces changes in our mood state, can result in depression, but depression can also cause chronic irritable bowel syndrome. So they're crosstalking. And now we start to recognize that the mediator of that happens to be these living organisms that sit in our intestinal tract, called the microbiome, the intestinal microbiome, of which there are literally hundreds, actually different thousands, of different critters that are bacteria, viruses, protists, fungi, that live in our intestinal tract. In fact, it is an organ unto itself, the microbiome. In most people, it weighs between 2 to 3 pounds in our intestinal tract. And just to give you a magnitude of what I'm speaking about, in 1 gram of stool, so that would be a 30th of an ounce of stool, there are more bacteria from our microbiome than there are stars in the known universe.
Wow.
Yeah, isn't that amazing? So we have all these living critters that can be of three different types in our intestinal tract. That's the microbiome. The three types are, they can be symbionts. Those are the type that produce good things. They produce vitamins, they produce immune activating substances, they make our immune system friendly, and they also speak to our brain in friendly terms through the chemical release of various substances through their metabolism. So that is the really good type, the symbionts. The second type are called commensals. The commensal family of microbes live in our gut. They don't do a lot of good, but they don't do harm. They just take up real estate. They kind of populate the environment, and so they prevent bad things from growing, but we wouldn't call them good or bad. We just call them friendly neighbors. Then the third ones, the ones we worry about, the third class, those are called parasitic. And those have things like Clostridia perfringens or Salmonella. There are many, many of these toxiform bacteria, and their personalities are kind of nasty. They produce secondary substances from their metabolism and from their living and death that then travel through our brain and nervous system, ultimately creating things like headaches or depression or mood swings or sleep disturbances, and as well as systemic problems like joint pain and things of that nature. So clearly we want as few of those as possible, and we want as many of the symbionts as possible. Now, to give you an example, in a really healthy person, many studies have been done on this, not only our work, but many others, in a gram of stool, as I mentioned, you may have something like 10 to the 13th organisms. That's 10, the number one with 13 zeros. That's a lot. Of those, about 10 to the 9th are, in a healthy person, are your symbionts. So the majority are symbionts. Maybe 10 to the 7th, 10 to the 9th. 10 to the 5th, 10 to the 6th, that's your commensals. And in a healthy person, you only have about 10 to the 3rd, or about 1,000 per gram of the bad ones, the parasites. But in an unhealthy person, the number of parasitic can increase dramatically. It can be an order or two or three of magnitude higher. Now you start having the bad mischief occurring that your body can't manage, and you have then what we call dysbiosis. Dysbiosis, and that leads to what's called leaky gut. Now, leaky gut means that you're starting to leak into your bloodstream and into your body's immune system mischievous molecules that have come from these bad bacteria. They're going to create all sorts of problems. And it alters your immune system function, alters your blood sugar, alters your nervous system. You think differently. You're not clear. You can get cognitive dysfunction. You can get foggy brain. And so this concept of a healthy microbiome is connected to a healthy immune system and a healthy brain function. So that's a part of our whole immunorejuvenation program, is to make sure we're supporting a healthy microbiome.
And these critters, especially the bad ones, can affect our cravings. So this is an oversimplification,
but
the bugs that thrive on sugar are more likely to make us crave those processed foods that are already built to be addictive. So once that snowball starts rolling, all of a sudden your cravings get ahead of you, and you're not fighting the same demons as people who have been eating kind of like a more balanced way for a period of time. So you can make it harder on yourself or a little bit easier on yourself, depending on how your lifestyle stacks up with what's going on in your gut and in your body. But fat as well, when it's stored on the body, can become metabolically active and wreak all sorts of havoc. So it's not just a simple solution that you can solve right away, but it's the sooner that you can get rid of those processed sugars and carbs, especially, and those non-foods that wind up in your gut, the better off you're going to be. And maybe you could speak to as well the amount of fillers, additives, chemicals, flavorings, and the rest of it, these non-food products that are in foods now that are wreaking havoc in our gut. And we don't even understand a lot of the things that are happening there because of these non-foods and kind of artificial things that are winding up inside our bodies, right?
Yeah, I think you said it very well, that we see now evidence that things that we presume were safe to put in foods, food colorings, flavorings, synthetic flavorings, preservatives, they were assumed to be safe because when you fed them to animals, they didn't kill animals. So we said, okay, they're okay for humans. But now that we have more precise ways of looking at these receptors on cells and seeing how they're influenced, the so-called G-coupled receptors that send signals to the rest of our body, and they sit on the surface of our gastrointestinal system, we start seeing things that we thought were safe by these new methods of what's called immunotoxicology or neurotoxicology are not safe. They actually set up bad messaging to our body. And in fact, even sugar substitutes we're starting to recognize are not benign. And we say, oh, we took sugar out of the diet. We gave these other things that produce sweetness without sugar, but we're finding that they also can be potentially sending up signals that create adverse effects on brain and mood and insulin and sugar management. So I think that this now is emerging to be a story where we used to see it as, oh, those are those rebels out there, those radicals that are talking about these things, and you don't need to worry about that because the government is telling this is all safe, and I mean, this is all food, isn't it? You've got a food label, it must be safe. Well, no, we're starting to see this new levels of research, more precise research, that are looking mechanistically at how these various substances work on the body, that goes back to the ancient wisdom that we grew up eating foods that were grown in the ground, not subjected to chemical processing, and that when they're eaten in that form, they are eaten in a way that will deliver to the body the evolutionarily patterned ingredients that are necessary to support proper gene expression for a healthy outcome and a healthy immune system. That, to me, is kind of relearning old tricks, the things that cultures have known for thousands of years, the blue zones where people live 100 years with good health, highly prevalent, are people that already knew that in their culture. They didn't have to relearn it.
And it's a little more difficult for us today in the modern world where we have so many bad choices all around us that are more addictive than ever. And it's something where we do have to put our shields up and be very intentional about how we're living our lives now. Whereas a few generations ago, that might not have been the concern. Maybe the concern was having enough food to eat, but your sources were more real, or you grew them in the backyard, or the soil was healthier, something like that. So I've heard you talk about the fact that to some degree, we've been losing ground in the world of health, but we don't have to be, right? And maybe part of the reason too is as you focus on treating the cause and not the symptoms, the cause of imbalance, let's say, can manifest in all sorts of different kinds of symptoms in different people. And it's this wide array of problems. So how do you reconcile that with the future that we're facing? How do we treat the cause in the right way instead of chasing all of these symptoms? And it seems like there are more symptoms than ever.
Yeah, I think that that's a really well stated again that, you know, people are, we like simple answers. All of us do. To complex questions. We like to think that we can get an answer and do one thing and it'll all be remediated or fixed. If you look at our society right now, let's use an example, long COVID. We're going to see in this country literally millions of people that are going to suffer from different degrees with different severity of long COVID. Some of those people never even had very serious COVID to begin with, but they're going to end up with the brain fog, the muscle pain, the sleep disturbances, the lack of focus and concentration that is associated with long COVID. And what is long COVID? Well, it's really not a disease. It's a syndrome. And it's actually been called the long COVID syndrome. What's the difference between a syndrome and a disease? A syndrome is very complex. It doesn't have a single origin. It doesn't have a single demonstrated cause. It affects multiple people in different ways, and it creates confusion as to what you do to treat it, because if you try to treat the symptoms, you're going to have to take a number of different drugs because there are so many different symptoms, and you're not treating the cause, you're treating the effect. So if we look at that chronic fatigue syndrome, for example, fibromyalgia syndrome, Lyme syndrome, post-Lyme syndrome, all of these fit into that family of these chronic problems. So you have to go and ask what is upstream, what may be the origin of these problems, where is the difficulty originating? And I think the evidence is more and more accumulating that the perpetuation of these chronic symptoms resides in these things that we're talking about. In your health of your microbiome, the health of your liver's ability to detoxify foreign substances. Many people have compromised liver function. As a consequence, they don't detoxify. They build up toxic loads of substances. The third is that they may have an immunological dysfunction as a consequence of the need to rejuvenate their immune system. The last is that they may have an energetic deficiency in the energy powerhouse of their cells called the mitochondria. And the mitochondria are these little furnaces that reside in our cells that produce all of our energy. And poisoning of mitochondria leads to energy deficit disorders. All of these are energy deficit disorders. They relate to being tired and wired and worn out. And so if you then manage those conditions upstream, not treating the downstream symptoms, but upstream cause, now you start to see the myriad of symptoms starting to be peeled away. You're not just treating symptoms, you're treating cause. And that's one of the things that we've really been focusing on for the last 30 years with functional medicine is, what are these things that we can do to treat cause and not effect? That was the focus of my book called The Disease Delusion. I really tried to say, get away from focusing on diseases, focus on where they came from. If we treat the cause and not the effect, we're going to be much better off in the long term. And in that book, I describe the therapeutic approaches that are used within functional medicine to achieve that. So I think that we're starting to witness a tremendous revolution in thinking that takes us away from wait till you get a disease and then find the treatment of choice, to, no, let's look upstream at the functional changes of what you got these chronic symptoms that are nagging and they get worse as you grow older. Let's get rid of them. Let's peel them away by treating their cause and not just their effect.
So what are some of the things that you're excited about coming in the future in terms of health? Because with more than four decades at this, I'm sure you've seen so many changes. And it's easy to look around and see the world as a dystopia, but there's reason, a lot of reason for optimism and hope as well. So maybe you could offer a bit of that.
Well, I'm definitely optimistic. You know, I'm optimistic as I look at my grandchildren. And they're thinking about their health, they're thinking about the environment, they're thinking about their food in very, very different ways than we did when I was a kid. We as children were all about snack foods and space food snicks and, you know, the newest processed foods that snack craft and popped and had colors and interesting flavors. And I think that now we're starting to see kids growing up having a more enlightened understanding of how all these things interconnect to their health, and that's encouraging. I think that the other thing that's revolutionary, that often I think we take for granted, because change occurs underneath us, and so we're caught up with our lives, and we often don't have the time and a moment to reflect on, whoa, there's a lot of really big stuff happening. I always remind myself what it must have been like to have lived during the Renaissance, you know, with all the new architecture and music and art. I mean, did people wake up on a day and say, look, I'm in the Renaissance, look at all this new art and music? Or they just say, oh boy, new stuff, people are building, and they took it for granted. And I think that's what we're doing right now, because I'm showing you two examples. This is an Apple Watch. This is an Oura Ring. These are just examples of the biometric devices that we now have for the first time in human history to be 24/7 sensing what our body is doing. They're not just fitness devices. They're biometric devices that are monitoring our physiology. Now, I know this because I published a couple of papers early on in 2020 with COVID, in which I started studying how people's Oura Ring values changed prior to them actually getting infected symptomatically with SARS. And what I found was that you would start seeing some 5 to 7 days before a person actually started having symptoms that their Oura Ring values, their heart rate variability, their temperature and sleeping, their sleep patterns, their heart rate would be changing, showing their body was under stress prior to actually getting sickness. And so that has then opened up a whole field of utilizing. When I say has opened up, it wasn't just my work, it was many other people working in this area as well, has opened up the field that now this Apple Watch, I have the new generation now, has an O2 device that measures my plasma oxygen levels in my blood oxygen levels. It measures my heart rate variability. It measures my fitness and sleep, but it also measures my heart rhythm. It does an EKG on my watch. So, and it can alert me if I have some cardiac irregularities. These are extraordinarily new tools, and we're right on the front edge of this. Now we have people wearing continuous glucose monitoring devices, CGMs.
Got one right here, yeah.
There we go. I've been studying those on my own body for the last, 4 years. And it's fascinating what you learn, isn't it, when you have a CGM. Like, you get into a stressful situation, you're not eating, and your blood sugar goes up. You say, hold it, I didn't eat. Why am my blood sugar going up? Because stress mobilizes sugar from your glycogen. So you learn all sorts of things about you and your relationship to your world that allows us then to start personalizing our approach, because no two people are identical in their response. So this is going to revolutionize health, I believe, because what's going to happen now with the cloud computing and with AI is that this information will be all collected silently. It will be transported automatically to the cloud. It'll be analyzed, and it'll spit back during the day saying, hey, did you know such and such? Maybe you want to do something. Maybe you want to eat more blueberries, or, you know, it could be any number of different recommendations that will make us all experts about our body. Now we will have precision as a consequence.
Well, Dr. Bland, it has been such a pleasure being with you here today. Before we go, can you tell folks where they can find your work, your book, and everything else that you've been working on in the past few years?
Oh, well, thank you. My book, The Disease Delusion, you can get it from Amazon or any bookseller. To follow me, you can go to jeffreybland.com, jeffreybland.com. We have all sorts of videos and podcasts you can download and different things that might be valuable. And most recently, we've been working on this immune rejuvenation program, which I'm really excited about. And that's a new little company I put together to really study immune rejuvenation and how we can deliver it to people. It's called bigboldhealth.com, bigboldhealth.com. And I would encourage people to check into Big Bold Health. I think you'll find some very interesting news to use, things that can really be actionable that make a difference in people's lives.
Brilliant. Well, Dr. Bland, it's been such an honor having you here with us here today. And I think we've gone into a lot of different topics that people, I would encourage them to look more deeply, because your work goes so much deeper than this. And there's so much of it out there. There's a lot to look forward to. I really appreciate your optimism. And I look forward to any other collaborations down the road, because you're just an absolute gem. And I appreciate your work so much. Thanks once again for being with us.
Well, you're very kind, and it's so, for me, feeding into my optimism when I have an opportunity to speak to someone like you that sees that we have some road ahead, but we also have opportunity to make those changes. So thank you very, very much. Really a privilege to be with you.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Woo! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate nut cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.